Until it's 13, about to get the gas, get the gas, get the gas. Until it's 17.
Well, this is an exciting day in the White House.
Get the gas, get the gas. Load it up.
Action News Network is an Aboriginal American media network. As such, we are protected under the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People, or DRIP, Articles 8, 14, and 16. Action News Network is allowed to provide Aboriginal news and media content on non-Indigenous media platforms free of oppressive censorship. Any breach of this protection is a breach of international law.
At the state of Sequoyah, most of us who are into the, call it American Aboriginal Studies, you probably heard of this proposed state of Sequoyah, Indian Territory, present-day Oklahoma, right? Basically, the state of Oklahoma was stolen from the Indians, all right? And if this is something that happens time and time again. We would make deals with these people, grant them land, they're not satisfied with the land, they wait till we have infighting, put us against each other, steal our land, force us to work on it, do bad deals. It's just an ongoing kind of thing. So, what we know as Oklahoma today was called Indian Territory up until the late 1800s. And there was even talk of splitting that territory in half because you had a lot of white settlers who was going to this land. Whites were in control of so much land that wasn't theirs that, they couldn't even stay out of the Indian Territory. And the reason why the Indian Territory was given to the Indians is because everybody thought it was barren land. It was barren, plains, it floods in a lot of those areas when it rains. The weather in the area wasn't that great. It wasn't, it was area that the whites didn't want, but of course, the Indians was gonna make the best out of it, And then when they started to find oil in these areas, because this was like during the middle of the Industrial Revolution, as they're going west, this is when you started seeing a lot of settlers coming to that area trying to strike it rich. While the government might have had certain protections saying that, okay, you guys have to respect the fact that Indians own that land and stuff like that, when enough of these white settlers come into the area and they start just disregarding the land, disregarding the rules and shit and doing whatever they want to do, when the Indians, who are not considered citizens and shit, when they start fighting back, it's considered a hostile enemy threat towards what they would consider their white American citizens. So it's a catch-22. The government is supposed to protect the Indians from, their own people, the white settlers coming to this land and disrespecting them on the land and stuff like that. At the same time, they would turn them blind eye. And then when the Indians attack them and try to kick them off the land, they have a right in their heads, in their minds, to send military force there. And that's what happened. So it says the state of Sequoyah was a proposed state to be established from Indian Territory in the eastern part of present-day Oklahoma in 1905, within the tribal governments looming, as prescribed by the Curtis Act of 1898. Native Americans of the five civilized tribes, the Cherokee, the Choctaw, the Chickasaw, the Creek, the Muscogee, and the Seminole in Indian Territory proposed to create a state as a means to retain control of their lands. All right, and this is what I was saying earlier. Their intention was to have a state under Native American constitution and governance. The proposed state was to be named in honor of Sequoyah, the Cherokee, who created the writing system in 1825 for the Cherokee language. So this is what the state would have looked like. It's basically the eastern and most southern eastern portion of Oklahoma at this time, bordering Texas. All right, and it was a constitutional convention in August 21, 1905. The convention president was Pleasant Porter. The vice president was William C. Rogers, Cherokee, William H. Murray, Chickasaw, Green McCurtain, Choctaw, John Brown, Seminole. It sounds like some brothers, don't it? And Charles M. Haskell, Creek. All right. Starting in 1890, when Congress passed the Oklahoma Organic Act, the land that's now made, that now forms the state of Oklahoma, was made up of two separate territories. Oklahoma Territory, this was the Indian territory that was spread, sparsely populated towards the western end of Oklahoma into the panhandle. And this area was where a lot of these whites were starting to encroach onto these sparsely populated lands where the Indians lived on the more fertile southeastern and eastern grasslands. All right, and in that area, this is where they started finding oil. Mind you, we know about what happened in Greenwood and Tulsa, and we're going to get into a lot of that because we're going to tie how the Tulsa race riots kind of don't make any sense unless you put it into the same perspective as that these people who were there, who they call just the Negroes or whatever, were blacks, Indians. Indians who were always been there, and they had control of this land, and it was making money off the oil. But we're going to get into that, okay? So Oklahoma Territory to the west and Indian Territory to the east. Indian Territory has a large Native American population. The territory has been reduced by quiet land cessions after the Civil War, land runs, and other treaties with the United States. In the 1900 U.S. Census, Native Americans composed 13.4% of the Native of the population in the future state. This makes no fucking sense. You see how they always do 13%? Where do we know 13% from, ladies and gentlemen? 13%, they like using that number 13 anyway. We already know about the properties of the number 13, but it's enough where it's enough people where you're not alarmed when you see, you know, Indians or black people or whatever in certain areas like that, but not enough for them to have a say. So that's why they always use 13%, okay? In 1905, the fossilized tribe have a total of about 16,000 persons in Indian Territory out of a total population of 600,000. There's just not enough white people. It doesn't make any sense. Their whole game is always making you feel like that they outnumber you 10-1. And that's what they do in these areas. And again, I hate, you know, saying white people. I hate, you know, doing that or whatever. When I say this, for lack of a better term, really it's just the government elites and shit. Because a lot of the Indians were involved in these numbers and in these fudging of historical facts and shit. You know, a lot of people we consider blacks today are still continuation of this this scheme, basically. Until 1903, the fossilized tribes and other tribes in Indian Territory has generally opposed all local and national efforts for statehood, whether they were single or joint with Oklahoma Territory. That changed as of the date set by Congress, March 4, 1906, for the breakup of tribal governments and communal lands and the territorial approach. Desire of tribal leaders to retain their historic authority and for the territory to be admitted as a single state. From Oklahoma Territory culminated in at the Sequoyah Convention, which met as a whole in 1905, August 21st and 22nd, and September 5th to the 8th. So you get the Sequoyah Constitutional Convention in Muskogee on August 21, 1905. General President Porter, Principal Chief of the Creek Nation, was selected as President of the Convention. Elect delegates decided that the executive officers of the five civilized tribes would also be appointed as vice presidents. This includes William C. Rogers, Principal Chief of the Cherokees, William H. Murray, appointed by the Chickasaw, Governor Douglas H. Johnson to represent the Chickasaws, Chief Green McCurtain of the Choctaws, or the Chattas, as we really should call them, the Chattas, Chief John Brown of the Seminoles, and Charles N. Haskell, selected to represent the Creeks as General Porter, had been elected president. Muskogee journalist Alexander Posey served as a secretary. Like I said, a lot of these names, man, you know, a lot of these names, I know people with names like this, no brothers with names like this. You know what I'm saying? These are the same names that we had for the longest and shit. The convention drafted a constitution, drew up a plan of an organization for the government, put together a map showing the counties to be established, and elected delegates to go to the United States Congress to petition for statehood on November 7, 1905. Voters in the territory approved the constitution and statehood petition by 56,279 to 9,073. Okay, although territorial leaders realized that the Republican-led Congress was unlikely to admit the heavily Democratic Indian territory into the Union, early in the 59th Congress, Representative Arthur P. Murray of Missouri and Senator Porter J. McCumber of North Dakota introduced Sequoyah statehood bills, which were defeated. President Theodore Roosevelt proposed a compromise that would join Indian Territory with Oklahoma Territory to form a single state, and resulted in passage of the Oklahoma Enabling Act, which he signed June 16, 1906. Oklahoma became the 46th state on November 16, 1907. Although it says Sequoyah never came into existence, its constitution made an important contribution to Oklahoma history by its many similarities to the later Oklahoma Constitution. They share an underlying populist distrust of elected officials. The convention also catapulted Haskell, Murray, and others further into the public arena, securing for Indian Territory a solid seat at the debate at the Oklahoma Constitutional Convention. So we'll continue. New York Times, this is published October 5, 1905. It's regarding the establishment of Sequoyah, the state of Sequoyah. This is an article from that set newspaper. An interesting campaign is in progress in Indian Territory to fossilize tribes of Indians comprising about 60,000 individuals acting independently of their nearly 600,000 other inhabitants of the territory. Appointed delegates who met in convention at Muskogee. And drafted a constitution which provides, among other things, for prohibition and statehood without Oklahoma under the name Sequoyah. At the election, which will be had in November, the adoption of this constitution, all the citizens of the territory have been invited to vote regardless of race or color. The arrangements for taking and counting the ballot are practically within the hands of the Indians and are as crude as the machinery of the old style mob primaries. In these circumstances, it would not be surprising if the election returns in November would show a large majority in favor of adoption of the Constitution. The election will be open to suspicion, however, and the results will not generally be looked upon and as expression the prevailing sentiment in the territory, either upon prohibition, the statehood question, or upon any other disputable provision of the Constitution. But although the coming election may be irregular, it cannot possibly be any more so than all former attempts which have been made to place on record the will and opinion of the people of the twin territories. So you see here, they already, this is a lot of the same crap you see going on with a lot of states now. We're bringing illegal immigrants, and also just when they have a certain population of people voting, right? So, no doubt. So New York Times is doing their job, which they usually do, which is bringing up white settlement. You know, they're not going to be on the side of the Indians. The Indians, of course, are blacks, that's right. Now, they're not how I told you how white people use the fake census to not only double, but like triple their numbers, right? So, a majority of population in Indian territory is going to be Indian. That's why I was called Indian territory. That's why they shipped all these Indians. No, not shipped, but they forced all these Indians to go into this territory. So you have all these whites running there now. So now you have a white minority who's holding half that territory hostage, you know, and you know, now they squandering any progress for the majority of the Indian population in that territory. And you know, they basically stole their statehood from them, right? So now you have New York Times doing their piece where they sympathizing with the plight of the white carpetbaggers, the white fucking settlers who was in the areas who are basically there as vagrants and vagabonds who are, you know, just basically mobbing these areas and shit. So let's continue. Let's see where I left off at. Upon the issues that mostly vitally concerned them, the many conventions that have been held and resolutions adopted, committees and delegations have been selected and sent to Washington, but in no instance have they represented more than individual groups of opinion. Separate statehood advocates have gotten together and voiced their settlement. Single statehood advocates have done likewise, but never have the citizens as a whole held a real constitutional convention or taken any other regular steps to show that they are deeply interested in that matter. The territorial press and politicians declare Oklahoma and Indian Territory are in need of statehood, but they do. I mean, hold on, my bad. But they do not seem to have a clear idea or positive and unalterable conviction as to the form or time in which it should be granted. Someone one state, someone two states, someone statehood for Oklahoma with Indian with the Indian Territory attached, and tribal governments going to abolish there, and their lands will be allotted and subject to taxation. See, they already trying to squeeze them out. They just gave them the territory, and now they're saying, now we don't want you to have. These little bit of whites came over there, and they're like, we got to get over there. And get it's all for the land grab. It's all for the land grab. So let's continue. Others want statehood with organic regulations on prohibition, women's suffrage, the Negro vote, trust, corporations, and other problems aggregated by racial Southern and Western reformers. While there is hardly a public man prominent or influential in the territories that has not changed opinion on these points time and time again. So I'm starting to think when they talk Negro that and separate Negro from the Indian, that the Negroes were the black what you call it, royalty that they took from Europe or whatever, the Scottish Highlanders. You look at the Union Jack, the Union of the Tribe of Jacob or whatever, and you see with the Ross and the Stuarts and all of them. I think those guys, they was keeping track of the whole time and shit like that. And that when they were separating the terms of different people, that these black Europeans were the ones who was considered the Negro here, while the blacks who were here, or just the people of color who were here in America were the Indians. You know, as a word that came from Spain or the Spanish, as the Niños de Indios. Or the children of God, right? So let's continue with this article. The practice of the patriots of the territories to blame and berate the East for preventing them from having statehood. Orators and editors persist in saying that the only reason the territories are kept out of the Union is that the Eastern states do not want it anymore. Western senators and representatives. This may or may not be true, but it might be as well for those who are abusing the East to consider whether the lack of interest, confusion of mind, and continual change of opinion, which we have noted above, are not the causes which have contributed. Which has contributed. That's all I have for this article right here. So now we can't talk about all of this for Sequoyah, Oklahoma, Indians, blacks, Negroes, whatever you want to say, right? I'm talking about Tulsa, Oklahoma. It's a very important city right here. And this would have been like the capital of Oklahoma, all of that. It was going to be the capital, most likely, of Sequoyah. But Tulsa is the second largest city in the state of Oklahoma. It's 45th most populous in the United States as of July 2018. Population 403,035. Damn near half a million. Which is a fairly decent sized city. An increase of 11,119 since 2010. So it's a fairly decent growing city. It's a municipal. It's the principal municipality of the Tulsa metropolitan area region with nearly a million people. All right. So it serves as the county seat of Tulsa County and is the most densely populated county in Oklahoma. All right. So this is not a small town or whatever. See, it has a fairly decent downtown skyline. Shit. One thing you gotta look at is known as the oil capital of the world. Okay? Tulsa Town, buckle with the Bible Belt. The city runs on oil. Alright? So you look at its location in Oklahoma, this is right where Indian Territory was. Alright, Indian Territory to the right of my little bubble right here is where Indian Territory would be at. All of this right here. So you see Tulsa is right there. Alright? It's an important city to the Indians and territory, alright? Tulsa was settled between 1828 and 1836 by the Lakapoka band of the Creek Native American tribe. For the most of 20th century, the city held the nickname of oil capital of the world. It played a major role of the most important hubs of the American oil industry. All right, the area where Tulsa now exists was considered Indian territory when it was first formally settled by the Lakapoka Creek tribes in 1836. They established a small settlement under the Creek Council Oak Tree at the present day intersection of Cheyenne and 18th Street. This area and this tree reminded Chief Turkabachi and his small group of trail survivors of the bend in the river and then previous Creek Council Oak Tree back in Tallahassee, Alabama. They named this new settlement Tallahassee, meaning old town in the Creek language, which later became Tulsa. The area around Tulsa was also settled by members of the other so-called five civilized tribes who have been relocated to Oklahoma from the southern United States. Most of modern Tulsa is located in the Creek Nation, with parts located in the Cherokee and Osage Nations. All right, or Osage Nations, depending on how you pronounce it. So the Tallahassee kind of goes along with Tallahassee. They all from the Creek language. All right. Although Oklahoma was not yet a state during the Civil War, the Tulsa area saw a share of fighting. The Battle of Tallahassee took place on the north side of Tulsa, and a number of battles and skirmishes took place in nearby counties. Just keep that in mind, all right? So there's always been skirmishes, especially between the white settlers encroaching on these territories over here, all right? After the war, the tribe signed a reconstruction treaties with the federal government. Then some cases required substantial land concessions. Again, like I told you, every time the settlers would encroach and they would complain to the government wouldn't do anything, so they had to take it to their own hands. And now you got a foreign entity fighting American citizens, so then the government is obliged to come and defend their citizens. All right, in the years after the Civil War and around the turn of the century, the area along the Arkansas River that is now Tulsa was periodically home to or visited by serious colorful outlaws, including the legendary Wild Bunch, the Dalton Gang, and the Little Britches. Okay, incorporation and oil capital prosperity. On January 28, 1898, Tulsa officially incorporated and elected Edward Calkins as the city's first mayor. Tulsa was still a small town near the banks of the Arkansas River in 1909 when its first oil well named Sue Bland No. 1 was established. Much of the oil was discovered on land whose mineral rights were owned by members of the Osage Nation under the system of head rights or birth rights, right? By 1905, discovery of the large Glenpool Oil Reserve, located about 15 miles south of downtown Tulsa, the site of present-day town of Glenpool, prompted a rush of entrepreneurs to the areas, or you mean thieves, to the areas. Growing number of oil fields, Tulsa's population swelled to over 140,000 between 1901 and 1930, unlike early settlers of northeastern Oklahoma who mostly migrated from the south and Texas. Many of these new oil-driven settlers came to Tulsa from the commercial centers of the East Coast and lower Midwest. This migration distinguished the city's demographics from neighboring communities. Tulsa has a larger and more prominent Catholic and Jewish populations than most Oklahoma cities, and is reflected in the designs of Tulsa's upscale neighborhoods. You can see this is Tulsa, Oklahoma. You know, I guess the layout of the city. See the Arkansas River in the southwest corner. Known as the capital of the world for most of the 20th century, city success in the energy industry prompted construction booms in the popular Art Deco style of the time. Profits from the oil industry continued through the Great Depression, helping the city's economy fare better than most in the United States during the 1930s. So now we got to go to the 1921 race riot. So this is about 22, 23 years after the 1828 establishment of the state of Oklahoma. So in this area here, you know, you gotta ask yourself, how was these black people allowed to own all this land, and how it was allowed to establish, you know, all this wealth and stuff. And nobody really asks where the wealth comes from, to really dig down and see what the wealth of most people in the Greenwood neighborhood. It came from oil sales. These people, you had all these black vagabonds and vagrants sneaking around trying to steal land, try to, you know, and a lot of them came and they had to work for a lot of these blacks, Indians, and all this shit on these, you know, oil fields and shit. The blacks worked around in furs and this and third. At the same time, you had a lot of people who were suffering, a lot of whites who were suffering and stuff like that. Poor, a lot of them were lazy, they didn't want to really work, you know what I'm saying? They just wanted to just do with vagabonds and shit, right? So, early 20th century, Tulsa was home to a black Wall Street, one of the most prosperous black communities in the United States at the time, located in the Greenwood neighborhood. It was the site of the Tulsa race riot, one of the nation's worst acts of racial violence and civil disorder, with whites attacking blacks. 16 hours of rioting on May 31st and June 1st, 1921 was ended only when the National Guardsmen were brought in by a governor, which they brought in and bombed the blacks. Why? And this is one reason why you realize when he was always saying, oh, blacks didn't have any rights and have any laws. I mean, didn't, like, rights anybody had to abide by, because you was considered an Indian or a foreign entity and shit, all right? So when they came and bombed this area, this was still, even though it became state of Oklahoma, this was still areas under foreign control and shit like that. So he was never really considered an American citizen, because he was still considered, you know, a part of these tribes or whatever. So, in an official report, and remember, the National Guards, that's why the National Guards, when they came in, they bombed that whole neighborhood. They bombed it. It wasn't just the whites who just rioted and burnt all the neighborhood down. They bombed the neighborhood. All right, this was one of the first. This was like the first terrorist attack on the United States soil. All right, and it was done against these Indians, I'm gonna say. All right. An official report claimed that 23 black and 16 white citizens were killed. Like I said, they always fudged the numbers with everything, all right? Because the estimate suggests that it was over 300 people died, most of them black. Over 800 people were admitted to the local hospitals with injuries, and an estimated 10,000 black people. That's a lot of fucking people, man, were left homeless, all right? As 35 city blocks composed of 1,256 residences were destroyed by fire, all right? So, yeah, property damage was estimated at $1.8 million. Efforts to obtain reparations for survivors of the violence have been unsuccessful, but the events were re-examined by the city and state in the early 21st century, acknowledging the terrible actions that took place. Wow, you acknowledged it. But at the same time, they wasn't acknowledging this shit for a while. This is why when people come to me and they try to like debate me on history and shit, just based off of some shit they might have heard in school, haven't really did the knowledge, haven't really did the reading, haven't really did the studying and shit, it gets a little bit fucking retarded and annoying, because time and time again, I can cite to different reports, different studies and shit like that, where we were taught one thing, and then eventually to do studies on it later on and find out that everything they were talking about was bullshit. All right, the official narrative is that 23 black people were killed, 16 whites were killed, but you know, when they looked at the records and shit like that, hundreds of people were fucking killed, and most likely they were all fucking black. You know what I'm saying? With just a few whites being able to be killed, especially when the National Guard came and bombed the whole fucking neighborhood out. Okay? They destroyed the whole fucking neighborhood, and they put all those rich black people into poverty and stuff like that if they didn't just kill them all. Okay? And this is something we've seen in other areas. You had the area of Rosewood in Florida. You had, you know, a lot of riots all over the fucking country where he was doing this fucking shit to Seneca Village in New York. You know, you had these fairly prosperous out Indian, aka Negro posts on the outskirts of towns and shit like that, where these people were prospering and staying to themselves, and they were killed, ran out, and had their property taken from them. Okay, so something we have to look at. So we look at the demographics of the city today. White American, 62%, non-Hispanic whites down from 85%, whatever. Black population, 15%. Latinos at 14. Native Americans at 5. So as we know, they split in them two groups up together, Native American and black. So you put them together, that's what, 21% about. And shit, still not like I said, they always lie about who's in, you know, the larger amount of population. I haven't been to this town, but I'm pretty sure the numbers are being fudged. Doesn't make no sense that this was Indian territory. This is where they moved all these Indians to. And to this day, even if you want to go with the original narratives of the stories that's being told to us historically, you know, that area has been reduced to 5.3% of a Native American population. Okay, it just doesn't make any fucking sense. And even if you add that with the black population to about 21%, still doesn't make any sense. And as you see the numbers, they told you 23 people were killed in them riots or whatever, when it was actually around a few hundred. So everything is being fudged, man. That you can't trust anything that they're telling you.